Do subscribe to Ekeeda channel and press bell icon to get updates about latest engineering, HSE and IIT JEE main and advanced videos.
So we saw an impulse turbine. There is only one kind of turbine, that is Pelton wheel. Now we are moving on to the next category of turbines called reaction turbines, which is a very important part of this chapter. Reaction turbines, we have two reaction turbines in the syllabus, Francis and Kaplan. So Francis turbine is a turbine in which the energy that we get from the jet is converted into both kinetic energy and pressure energy. Unlike Pelton wheel, where all of the energy of the jet was converted to kinetic energy and what it was used for moving the turbine, it was used for running the turbine. So hence the name was impulse. All the energy was converted into velocity, and velocity is nothing but kinetic energy, which happens inside the nozzle. Here in Francis turbine, you don't have nozzle, so the energy that we get from the jet has to be converted into both. A part of it is converted into velocity, a part of it is converted into pressure. So here in reaction turbines, we have both the pressure energy and the kinetic energy. So both the energies are used to run the turbine, and hence the constructional features, the working and the formulas and the derivations are a bit different from the Pelton wheel. Also the velocity triangle is a little different. So we'll see the constructional features first of all of the Francis turbine. So the Francis turbine, as I said earlier, is a type of a reaction turbine in which the input energy is converted into both pressure and kinetic. So a part of the energy is kinetic, a part of it is pressure energy, and both the energy has to be used to develop power. So what happens in Francis is the jet that comes in, it comes in radially and it moves out axially. So it's a type of turbine which is having a radial inlet and an axial outlet, whereas in Pelton wheel the inlet was tangential, correct, and the outlet was along the axis, that is axial. Here in this case the inlet is radial and the outlet is axial, so it is a mixed flow turbine, you can say, where the inlet comes out axially and the outlet is along the axis, so it is axial outlet. So let me draw the front view and the top view of this Francis turbine. So as you can see in the front view, I've drawn there is a scroll casing. I mean, there's the second part called as guide vane, and then we have a runner, and then we have something called draft tube, and there is tail race. So as the water enters into the scroll casing, it comes from penstock, it enters into the scroll casing, and it just goes around the circumference and goes into the guide vanes. What a guide vane does is it is made of an aerofoil shape, so the water passes through the guide vanes such that there's no friction, and it makes a particular angle and it just enters into the runner blades and strikes the runner blade. So just the guide vanes help to make the water enter into the runner without any shock, without any friction. So it's a frictionless process. So the guide vanes are made of aerofoil shape, so there is no there are no losses available, and once the water enters into the runner, it generates power, and then the remaining water, then through the draft tube, it comes into the tail race. And another thing, the draft tube is a very useful thing in Francis turbine, because when the water comes out of the runner, it has some kinetic energy, and the pressure is generally below atmospheric pressure. So there are chances of getting cavitation into the turbine. We'll go into cavitation afterwards. So there are chances that there are bubbles produced, there are separations created. So what draft tube does is, it's a diverging kind of a tube. So when the water goes down, the pressure goes on increasing and the velocity goes on increasing. So the pressure increases, which prevents cavitation, and also the separation. So that's the use of draft tube. And as I said, guide vanes are used to make the water enter into the runner at a particular angle without any shock and without any friction. Scroll casing, they help to guide water to move into the guide vanes. Remember, there is no nozzles in this turbine, because these turbines are completely packed. There is no air leakage is allowed, because here, as I said earlier, there is pressure energy also available, unlike Pelton, where you can have an open structure because there is no pressure available. So here the scroll casing is always full of water, it has pressure. So if there are losses, if there are leakages, there will be pressure loss, and ultimately it will lead to loss in the efficiency of turbine. So there's no leakages allowed in this type of turbine. So I'll write down the name of the parts. So these four are the main important parts of the Francis turbine. As I said, each one of them has their own specific use. I'll tell you once again, scroll casing, what it does is, it's just a guide which helps the water go into the guide vanes. So, and the scroll casing is designed in such a way that the cross section area of the scroll casing goes on decreasing when the water passes through it. And since the cross section area goes on increasing, it goes on decreasing, it helps to maintain constant velocity. That's the use of scroll casing. Next, after the water passes through scroll casing, it moves into the guide vane. Guide vanes are just aerofoil shaped structures on which the water strikes, and it moves through the guide vanes into the runner without any shock and without any friction. And now, as the water enters into the runner, it creates impulse, also momentum, and it pushes the runner, it starts rotating and power is generated. And after the water moves out of the runner, it passes through draft tube. It is a diverging type of a tube in which the pressure energy increases, and the pressure energy increases, and hence it avoids cavitation, and finally the water enters into the tail race. So that was all about the construction features of the Francis turbine. So that was all about this topic. Next is, we'll be looking at the derivations for hydraulic efficiency, mechanical efficiency in work done.